We are very honored to have the chairman of the Wiat tribe, Ted Hernandez, and his son, Matt, visiting us today. Thank you for being here. So we have a lot to cover. My name is Danielle Knapp. I'm the Makosh Associate Curator here at the Jordan Schnitzer Museum of Art and the co-curator of the exhibition, Rick Bartow, Things You Know But Cannot Explain. On behalf of myself and our director and co-curator, Jill Hartz, and all of our staff, we are so happy that you're here today. We're so happy to be a place where people are coming together to celebrate Rick Bartow. Our moderator for this morning's tribute to Rick is Dr. Rebecca Dobkins. Rebecca. She joined the faculty of Willamette University in 1996 after working as a researcher at the Smithsonian Institution's National Museum of Natural History. Among her many curatorial projects as curator at the Hallie Ford Museum are The Art of Ceremony, Regalia of Native Oregon, which was awarded a National Endowment for the Arts in 2008 American Masterpieces Grant, as well as exhibitions featuring the work of Marie Watt and Joe Federson, and biennials for Crow Shadow Institute of the Arts and many other exciting projects. And as you may already know, she was also the curator of the 2001 retrospective of Rick's work, My Eye, that traveled to several other venues through 2004. We are so pleased to have her here today to lead a discussion with the esteemed artists who have traveled, in some cases, very far to join us for this program. So I'd like to introduce you to Lillian Pitt. Seiichi Hiroshima. Frank LaPena. And James Lavadour. And our chief curator, Ann Rose Kitagawa, will be joining us to assist with translation for this morning's program. And we have so many great programs planned for this exhibition while it's on view through August 9th that I won't go through a full list of them right now. But if you can pick up a copy of our events calendar or a members magazine or look on our website, you'll see a list of many other programs that are in response to the exhibition and other issues. So we hope to see you again throughout the spring and summer. And thank you so much for being with us today. And I'd like to introduce Rebecca.
Thank you, Danielle. So let's take seats, okay? Up here, if we can get comfortable. Not you, Bartow. You sit down there. So I'm Rebecca, and I'm really happy to be here. Before I talk a little bit about the format that we're going to follow, and I'm going to start with a few words myself, I'd like to know who's here. So those of you who consider yourselves dear friends of Rick, could you raise your hands? All right. See, that's what I figured. There's a lot of people. So all of you could be up here telling stories. Those of you who have collected Rick's work, who live with Rick's work in your home. Oh, good. Yes, me too. Look at that, Rick. You should be looking. So here, you stand up. Come here. Come here. Come here, honey. All right, just a minute. So could you say that again? All of those who live with Rick's work in their homes. In any form, okay? Books or whatever. Okay. And then those friends of Rick's, if you could raise your hands. Okay, see? Look at all that love out there. And then folks who are here because they're really connected to this museum and this university. Probably that's lots of other folks. Okay, great, great. Okay, that helps me out a lot. Any students here? Well, we're all students, but okay, great, great. All right, good, thank you. Okay, anything else you want to know about these people?
Can I sit down?
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Well, let me just say a couple of things about how we're going to operate today. We thought it was really important to have this kind of conversation in public for this occasion, because, of course, what makes us all living and breathing and able to do the work that we all do and the work that Rick inspires are our personal connections and our stories who make us who we are, and we wanted a chance to bring that out to you. And we know that there will be a lot of you who have questions or who have stories yourselves. And to honor that, we do have these cards that are around so that you can feel free to write your questions, to write your stories out. We will, in all likelihood, not be able to hear. I know we will not be able to hear them, but we'll collect those cards, and the conversation that we start this morning can continue when Larry Fong and Rick go into the galleries at 2 o'clock, and they can just continue in a variety of formats, so thank you. And what I'm going to say a few words, and then each of our panelists will speak, ask them to tell just one story. So that will be interesting to see if they do what I tell them, which never happens with these folks. But Lillian will go first, and then Say will speak next. Frank LaPena will follow Say, and then Jim Lavadour will share his story. So I think that's how things will go. Deepest thanks to the museum for making this happen and to all of you for being here to support this experience. So the couple of things that I want to say are that I'm really aware that Bartow comes from world renewal people. And the WIOT people, and I'm so happy that Ted and Matthew are here. That's so marvelous. And many other people in Northwest California and Southwest Oregon celebrate world renewal ceremonies. And there's something amazing about this whole concept of having the world remade and the human role in that world, not a role of hubris, but a role of responsibility and possibility and obligation, so that we're constantly reminded about the work of creativity and the incredible gift that living represents. And Bartow has had the opportunity to renew himself, not just the opportunity, he's had the necessity of renewing himself again and again and again. And in these last couple of years, post-stroke, what he has done has been an extraordinary inspiration, I think, to all of us who know him on whatever degree of intimacy. So watching him play and sing last night was incredibly inspiring for all of us. So the one short story that I wanted to share before I turn it over to Lillian, and so I'm going to sit down because now I'm not moderator, now I'm storyteller, is that I wanted to talk for a moment. I wanted to remember someone who is not here. I'm going to try to get through this. Is Harry Fonseca. And some of you know about Harry's work. And Harry was someone who was important to many of us. And for me, Harry Fonseca, who is a Maidu artist who passed away a few years ago of a brain tumor, before I came to Oregon, I was friends with Harry, good friends with Harry, and with Frank LaPena. And Harry, when he knew I was coming here, he said, you know, you really have got to get to know Rick Bartow. And he also said, you got to really get to know Lillian Pitt, too. And when then I came here, and part of our my job at Willamette was to help create the Hallie Ford Museum, it was very clear to me that the very first project that I needed to do, a major project that I needed to do after caring for our collection, was to do a one-person show for Rick Bartow. And I knew that because of Rick and his work and what it has, what was, he had already accomplished by the year 2000. But Harry always emphasized how important doing one-person shows are. Having the opportunity for all artists, but especially for Native artists, to have this meaningful chance, as we have upstairs, to see someone's work in its complexity and its multiple incarnations and over much time. So when I see that work up there, I think a great deal about Harry. And I also think about what has happened in the last couple of days, what will continue to happen, And the story I want to share just very, very briefly, 2 minutes, will be to let you know of the heroic thing that Harry Fonseca did when Rick had an exhibition in Portland in the fall of, was it Charles 2007? Was it 2006? I don't know. Rick had a one-person show, a small one, but an important one, at the Oregon Historical Society, and Harry was dying of a brain cancer. In fact, a brain tumor. He was. We didn't know this, but he was going to die that December, and this was October, I think. And Harry called me up, and he said, "And Harry's having seizures. Harry's hadn't traveled. Harry'd been in and out of hospitals," and he said, "I am coming to Bartow's opening, and I am going to surprise him. And so don't tell anyone, especially don't tell Lillian, because she has such a big mouth." And Harry and his partner, who we also always call Tucson Harry, because he was also Harry, arrive for Bartow's exhibition, and the love and the tremendous excitement and the friendship that was represented in that trip was amazing, made more amazing because Harry continued to have seizures. We spent much of the evening after Bartow's reception at the VA hospital, where Harry was struggling mightily. That is the kind of love that Rick deserves and that Rick inspired, and the kind of love that makes possible everyone's work. Because really, it comes down to love. And world renewal comes down to love and living and creating and solving the problems that can be solved through art. So that's the story that I wanted to share, thinking about Harry and thinking about Rick and thinking about the hard work that living is and the love that, if you're really lucky, you get through your work and through your friends. So, Lillian, get yourself together. That's like, you're not going to blubber. You're going to be just fine. Tell a funny story now.
Okay. Oh. You know, when you have friends like Rick and Harry and Joe and Say and Frank and Jim, you know, anything's possible. And it seems to give us all energy when we get together. We seem energized, and Anna Lee and you know, and Bartow here, you're just at the throng of things. You're in the heart of everybody. And you know, I love you, and I'm not gonna blubber. And so, thank you guys for coming. It's just a treat to come down and tell a story about Rick, and it's horrible that it's one story. And so, and speaking of things that you know but cannot explain, I had to bring this whole thing down. This happened in 1990, and another crazy guy, Royal Nebaker, called me and said, "Let's do a papermaking workshop in Clatsop Community College or in Gearhart." And he said, "Naoaki Sakamoto would like to come over and make paper." And then Royal said, "Well, we need to write grants. We don't have any money." And then so we just worked all together to gather money to bring Harry down. Harry rented this little car, and he's just this big, tall guy, and he unfolded out the car. And a couple Alaskans at New Paper flew down with cedar, yellow and red cedar, down to make paper, and they were the only ones that knew what they were doing. But Rick and my job, well, Rick didn't know it was his job, but things you know you can't explain. So I asked him, Rick, we need to do a dance, and you've got to make a costume. And so that whole summer, I gave him a summer, and he went out to the cow pastures and found all these old bones and found things at garage sales. You found this one great big spoon that you made a mask out of, and who knows where you found things. And not only did he make the costume for himself, he made us musical instruments, and they're actually noisemakers more than instruments. And so he gave me an antler that was notched, and then I rubbed it like Frank's rattle was yesterday. And I tried to find it to bring it, but I must have put it away someplace. And so I forgot, I don't have it. And so... So anyway, so we got together, and he must have made 30 instruments for all of us, all different, just beautiful, just shells all wrapped together with rocks in them that you rattled. And I had the rattling thing. And so, but we didn't know really how to use them, how... Nobody choreographed us, and so we went on the stage, and now went first with the drum, and then Rick was behind him, and they started hollering. This was at a big theater in Astoria, and now and Rick were hollering. Then we thought, well, maybe we should holler too, and so here we go. Whoop! And so, you know, we weren't in sync or anything, and we just thought we were just the greatest people on the planet, you know. rattle. And then it was over, and then all of a sudden we looked out, the audience was so stunned into silence, and we didn't know what to do with ourselves, so we just kind of sidestepped back off the stage, and and then the next day we bowed out. Royal says, you know, Lillian, I hate to tell you this, but we didn't get that grant. Yeah, I didn't tell Rick, until 2 years. And so, but you know, when you have a close-knit friendship like that, anything is possible. And we did something so wonderful with the paper-making workshop, and then now was so impressed with Rick and all of us crazy guys that he took us to Japan and introduced us to them with the low-tech paper-making. And that's where I met Sei, and so the connections are just worldwide. And so, Rick, you've been there all the time, and that's my story. And it's a nice one, huh? Yeah.
No. I don't know. I didn't know.
Okay. I do.
You do?
I forgot both languages, English and Japanese now.
because I still have a jet lag. Okay. Yeah. Speaking Japanese, okay? She will interpret in a beautiful English. No. Okay. Yes. Yes. I. We have. No. 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 リックとの話をするときにはですね、共通の友人である、あの今リリアン・ピットも言った、坂本直明、直明坂本直さんの話をしなきゃいけないと思うんですけど。
So it's my pleasure to be here to speak today about Rick and this wonderful cohort of friends, including Lillian and Naoki Sakamoto, the papermaker.
彼は東京に、紙を扱う、店を持ってるんですけども、新潟県小国町山の田という、大変小さな部落にも彼の、工場というか、紙すき場を持っています。
So Sakamoto-san has a place in Tokyo where people can purchase paper, but has a wonderful studio factory where the paper is actually created in Yamanota City, in Niigata.
Nao-san とはもう、リックと知り合う前からずっと、知り合いで、彼のとこから非常に高い紙を買わされてました。
So I have known Nao-san for many, many years, and he has always been very kind in supplying very lovely and expensive paper.
Very expensive. で、リックは多分4 times you come to Japan. So always, I know.
I can translate into Japanese if you'd like.
Let's mix up.日本に来るたびにですね、ナオさんのところの山の田の、小さな小さな小屋に泊まって、彼はそこの小さな町が本当に大好きで、春、夏、秋と、今まで3シーズンそこで過ごしました。
So Rick has come to Japan 3 or 4 times, and every time he goes, he enjoys going to the small town of Yamanota, where Nao has this studio, and we have gone together in 3 seasons, in spring, in summer, in autumn, not yet in winter.
日本に来る大体外国の観光客というのはですね、大体京都とか奈良とか、大体そういう観光地を巡るんですが、リックは日本に3回、4回も来て、そういうところには一度も行ったことがありません。
So, usually when foreign tourists come to Japan, they go to major tourist centers like Kyoto or Nara. But Rick has spent most of his time going to this very small, very beautiful, town of Yamanota.
変な外人です。
A very strange foreigner.
それでですね、小国町、その新潟県小国町にですね、新福寺という、禅寺、わかりますよね、禅寺があるんですが、そこの山門にですね、木食、商人という、江戸時代の、坊さんが、作った阿吽という、木彫の、2メーター以上ある、彫刻がこう山門の両側にあるんです。
So, Yamanota is part of a larger town called Oguni, in which there is a small temple called Shinpukuji of the Zen Buddhist sect. Shinpukuji has an entry gate that has 2 meter tall wooden sculptures created by an Edo period monk sculptor, Mokuji Kishonin, that are called A and Un. And forgive me, I'm going to put on my art historian hat here and explain. A and Un are the Sanskrit sounds that are made that indicate that one sculpture's mouth is open, A, and the other's mouth is closed, M. These are works that Rick very much admired.
それで、リックからは、私も、阿吽の像を、そこの神福寺に、作って奉納したいということを、よく聞いていたんですが、2007年、2007年、彼の4度目かの、来日の時にですね、それが実現して、私もその時彼の彫刻本の助けたんですけども、とにかく完成しました。それでお寺に納めました。
So, Rick wanted very much to create Ah and Un sculptures to donate to the temple, especially in the aftermath of the Niigata earthquake that destroyed much of the town.
その2007年
2007年、
私たちが行く前に新潟にものすごく大きなアースクエイクがあって、その山本の小さい町はほとんどの家がもう壊れてしまって、もともと山本は年寄りオールマンが多いところだったんですけども、やっぱりそこにはもう住めなくなって、みんな山の麓の方へ引っ越してしまいました。だから、ほとんどゴーストタウンみたいな感じでした。
So, in 2007, there was the great Niigata earthquake. And in that earthquake, many of the buildings in the town of Yamanota, which is at the top of the mountain, were destroyed and fell down. Most of the people moved away. Most of the people who were still living there were growing much older, so it was a sort of elderly population. And so they relocated further down the mountain, leaving what was essentially a ghost town.
それで、その彫刻というか、そのアウンの像を作ったんですが、その材料は何かというと、倒れたうちの、梁、2メートル、3メートルぐらいある梁を2本、家主さんから許しを得て、使わせてもらいました。大変硬い木で、リクと私はその山門の前でこうカンカンカンカンやりながら、すごい硬い木だなと思ったことを覚えてます。
So, in order to have materials to create the sculptures, we got permission from someone whose house had fallen down to use one of the 2 or 3 meter long roof beams made of keyaki wood. So it was material from that actual town that was used, and very, very hard wood. And I remember the sound that it made as we were sculpting it.
で、あ、それ掘り終わってですね、ある日、リクと私で、新潟県にあるコースサイドの柏崎という、魚市場、フィッシャーマンのマーケットがあるところなんですけど、そこへ、行きました。
So, one day when we were taking a day off, having a break, we decided to go down towards Nagaoka village, towards Kashiwazaki beach, in order to have seafood, because there are many fishermen there.
そこでですね、You remember? その魚市場、フィッシャーマンズマーケットではいろんな食べ物を売ってるんですが、非常にいい匂いがしてきた。
So in the fisherman's market, there are many, many different types of things to eat, and it smells wonderful.
He found, 彼はイカの丸焼きを見つけました。
So he found squid or calamari that had been grilled.
で、子供のように食べてました。
And ate it like a child.
Now you remember.
And more. He took mine. Yeah. Italy. 先ほど言いましたように彼は、春、夏、秋しか来てない。で、 いつか冬に行きたい。言ってたんですけども。
So, as I had mentioned before, he has come to visit in spring, in summer, and in fall. He says that he would like to come in winter.
だけど山本の冬はものすごく寒くて、雪がもうこの天井ぐらい降りますので、彼を山本に置いてったら生き延びれるかどうかわからないと僕はやめにします。
So, but Yamanota is very high in the mountains, and it gets extremely cold, and the snow piles up to the roof of the building, and so maybe not the most advisable time of year to go to visit.
And again, one more squid again in summertime. I promise you. That's it. Thank you.
Hear me? Yeah, there. Oops. That I have to add, because I didn't know this was the story that Seiichi was going to tell. And it's wonderful to me to think of Rick making these sculptures out of reclaimed wood from the aftermath of an earthquake. Because if I understand the jump dance right, the jump dance is part of the world renewal ceremonies that Rick participates in and participated in with the Wiat last year when they resumed their jump dances, their world renewal ceremony after having been interrupted by horrible historical experiences from 1863, right? It was the first from 1860? 1860 was the massacre. So the last year, Rick participated in these dances, in the jump dance down at Humboldt Bay, and if I understand things correctly, and please correct me if I don't, that part of the motion of the jump dance in which the men really do jump, and it was cold, and it happened over 3 days, and Rick had not long before experienced his stroke, and he got out there and danced with those young guys and looked pretty good, you know, not too bad. But the jumping, as I understand it, is part of the motion of earthquake, of responding to earthquake. And earthquakes, if I understand it, in that worldview, are about resettling the world. Not so much unsettling the world, but getting the world resettled. Is that right? So those sculptures, that dance, have a lot to do with each other.
Let's go.
Okay, Frank.
All right. Hearing all these stories, you know, we're sitting there trying to figure out what are we going to say. But anyway, you know, having looked at it, another artist who is very successful and who is very humble and who is damn busy with great stuff, it's inspiring, like has been mentioned. But my story really talks about one of the times he had returned from Japan. And he had a show at Sakata. And so he came down for the show, and I didn't really tell him what we're gonna do, but he came down, had the reception, it ends kinda late, and I said, we're gonna go on a trip. So this is our bear dance, you know, and the bear dance is for the new year. So I said, we're going on a trip. So off he went, from Sacramento to Reno to Susanville. And from Susanville, we went up the hill from there. And we were going to the bear dance. And what we did is we pulled in. Now, this is, he'd been all awake all day, so had I. And we pull in to the ceremonial grounds at 4 o'clock in the morning. So there's a hand game going. So we said, we gotta get in this hand game, you know. So he had to make sure that he didn't spend all his money because he said he liked hand gaming. And so we went there, finished that, and then to do the ceremony, you have to do it before the sun comes up. So we have to prepare for our flag, which represents the rattlesnake. We have to do the hide. And then if we do it right, when the sun comes up, then we will have initiated. And if you don't do that, you will not have the ceremony. So we did that. And then we came out after the morning general prayer and hang the things and talk about it. And so we asked people, this is a time that you can make a blessing or thank the year or thank the spirit. And so I asked if he would do something, you know, and he was kind of reluctant because this is a little bit out of his territory. But it is a time when anybody can say anything. And what he did is he got up and, you know, apologized for being outside, but said the things that were proper, you know, respecting the earth, respecting the area. And then he did bird songs. And then he also, you know, was present in a real natural way. And then, of course, as the day goes on, we have dances and that. And we have the ceremony time is when you now have the bear doing the kind of thing. So I had always been talking about different dances and that and bear, and I knew he was always interested in bear, so this is another way to bring the bear into his sense of how it was done in the mountain area. And it was something that every time I see his bear, you know, I'm thinking, wow, this is the bear again. And so when I see the bear, it's like when I see the coyote, it's sort of like when I see all those different beings, you're assembling the reality again, but you're assembling with a question of how can you make a truth be evident to the common folks, to those who aren't artists. And so I think that when you see this show, you are taken by the energy and the creativity of gathering together pieces of this reality that becomes a dog or a bear or whatever. And then, of course, with the paintings, it becomes an inspiration for artists to see that. And so there's a lot of ways that he comes across that are important to those of us who are creative, but to remember what being alive is about, the ceremony and tapping into that energy. So that, I thank you very much.
Hey. Well, I'm very pleased to be here. There isn't an artist that I know personally that I respect more and I've learned more from than Rick Bartow. First time I encountered Bartow was in Seattle at the Sacred Circle Gallery. I had been dabbling in figurative work and I'd, you know, in contemporary art world, landscapes were very, you know, it, not well received. And so I had, you know, I'd been doing, you know, looking at the German artists and everything that was happening in Europe. And Jim Halliday called me and said, you gotta look at this Bartow guy. And so next time I was in Seattle, he spread some things out and it was like somebody had dropped a piano, you know, boom. and it was just resonant. You know, they made noise. You know, and his marks were incredible marks. You know, and they were musical. They had power to them. They had energy. You know, they had a life of their own. The mark itself, and so the whole work was like this tapestry, this cacophony of sound and color and bones and teeth and gnashing, you know, hair and kind of wild things. And every once in a while, there's an eye looking back at you. It's like, and it's kind of funny. It's like, are you, you know, it's like Bartow looking at you. You know, you're looking at all this stuff, and all of a sudden you see this eye, and that's Bartow. You know, he's looking at me. And I was just really stunned, you know, by his creativity. And inspired, absolutely. And and then we had exhibitions all over the place. We're in museums and all over the world. And Bartow, for me, Bartow set the pace. You know, and it was a quick pace. It wasn't a, you know, a lolling thing. It was a driving force. And for all these years, that was more than 30 years ago. And never let up, and when he had a stroke, I thought, "Oh my God!" You know, I had friends who had strokes and lost all their abilities and all that, and that's the first thing I asked Charles Froelich. I said, "Can he still paint?" And they say, "Well, we don't know yet, you know, and we'll know." And I went to the exhibition, his first exhibition at Froelich Gallery after a stroke. Absolutely amazing energy. You know, it was a force of nature, and it was rich and ever giving. You know, it's generous work Rick does, and compelling, and it takes you right down to the bottom of being a human being, and it gives you some music to accompany you and a little dance, you know, and it lightens your load. You look at Rick's work, and it really elevates your spirit. And so I just want to thank you, Rick Bartow. You're a great artist. So.
So what I would like to suggest now is those of you who are writing things on cards, if you could pass them to Danielle, and maybe if Larry is being part of that as well. And while we're doing that, there's one other artist that I would like to just mention, and then I wondered if Bartow, I want to give you a chance to say a word or two if you are so inclined, and if you, Chair Hernandez, would like to say anything at all. But that's Joe Federson. And Federson and Pitt and Bartow have long been the rat pack and have, you know, boy, they are just hell to be in the same room with because they're just a mess, aren't they, Charles? Oh, my God. So I'm thinking a lot about Joe, and about that Joe is from the Colville Reservation and taught for many years at Evergreen with Gail Tremblay, who's also with us today. You know, the three of them together have been, for me, real mentors as artists, and they've been very patient with me, as have Frank and Jim. They've taught me a great deal about what it means to curate, care for, steward, interpret, hold closely and tightly and loosely other people's art. And so I'm thinking about Joe and probably some trouble he's in this morning. So I'm sure he sends you, I don't know, he probably would swear at you if he were here, but he wouldn't really mean it. He'd be, yeah. So when those cards are ready, if someone could slip them to me, and in the meantime, would you like to say anything at all?
Thank you. You know, I have a couple of stories myself, and I think the best one is when we went to the Smithsonian, and Rick asked us to do a brush dance there. So we went up there with me and my youngest dancers. And when we got there, we saw Rick, and I said, Rick, you're going to dance. He goes, but I don't know how. I go, don't worry about it. It comes natural. And I was surprised because he got dressed with us guys, and we all got dressed. And it takes a while to get ceremonial dress for Galeon. And we got Rick, on, you know, all dressed up. And so most of you have been to the Smithsonian. That floor is hard. I mean, it's a hard floor to dance on. So we got out there, and we started dancing. And then we all looked, all my guys looked at Rick and said, is he going to jump? Is he going to jump center? Because this is a brush dance. It's a dance for healing a child. And so we're all looking at Rick. And next thing you know, here comes Rick. He starts jumping center. And then my youngest guys get out there and started jumping with him. And it was a privilege to see my youngest dancer, who was at the time 6, and our oldest elder dancer dancing at the same time. It was an experience. And then we got to real close, and Rick adopted me into his family, and my family adopted Rick, so that's why we call him our uncle, you know, out of respect. So he stayed with us at our house for a week during the summer, and I felt sorry for Rick, I really did. Because here's my kids running around, taking them everywhere, taking them sightseeing, but the best part was my wife. She was always trying to get Rick the herbal medicine to heal. And I felt sorry for Rick, I really did, because my wife, she will pester you and pester you until you take it. And I told her, like, Uncle, I'm sorry, but that's how Rose is. And, you know, when she finds out Rick ain't doing it, she kind of growls at Rick. And she goes, especially when we came out, she goes, she can make sure that your uncle's taking his medicine. I said, I will, I'll make sure, but I'm going to keep you off the hook on this one. But we love Rick dearly. And, you know, to see him interact with my kids and the little ones, it's an awesome feeling. And like you said, the world renewal ceremony, that was another awesome ceremony. Rick came down, was in a nice motel, and me and two other my guys, we went up to the room. You know, he thought we were just going to visit him, but actually we kidnapped him. So we told him, you're going to be camping out with us, and you're going to be fasting with us for the next 10 days. And he did. He did it. And to see him tell the stories to the youngsters and, you know, guiding them and teaching them the ways was a great feeling. And then we did our dance on the island. It turned out to be one of the best dances ever. And then we jumped over to the next Piedmont, which was a traditional village site where we danced. And then we brought it home to the reservation. And that day was cold. It was very windy. And I was the lucky one. I was still in my shirt, my clothes and everything. My dancers, they had to be in deer skins, and they had no shirts on. And so you know they were cold. And I was by the fire. And here I'm watching my uncle dance with the younger guys, and they're jumping, and they're saying their prayers up to the Creator. And then that cold breeze came in. And in Humboldt County, it gets cold because that fog starts coming in. And I never once saw my uncle shiver. Never once did I see him shiver. I seen the other younger guy shiver, but not my uncle. He was like a rock. But to see him accomplish the dances, and you know, to see his face, to see the headdress, which he hasn't been able to see in a long time, and actually hold and wear, was a great feeling. And for him to complete the dance that never completed in 1860 was another great feeling. You know, he's done. He says he's done those too, but I got more news from him. We got more dances coming up that he'll be participating in. And he did, you know, we will kidnap him if we have to. So we're planning on the deerskin dance, the boat dances, and he's going to be a partake of it. And then he can say he's completed all the dances, but we'll create more for him so he can continue to go. So those are my stories, and I would like to thank you guys for honoring my uncle here today. You know, it's a great pleasure for us to be here as a Wiat tribe, to see our elder being represented for his work. Thank you.
Unna nikam ka, ha ha ha, hey. Unna nikam ka, ha ha ha, hey. To the north, to the east, to the south, and the west, above, below us, all around, everywhere. Say thank you in that way that it was taught. Tobacco, not to smoke for the Creator. In a certain way, then it seemed to pray. To say thank you to all these people who've told very lovely lies. Please, forgive them. They're just having fun. I have a big, what did grandfather used to say? You had a big shirt and a little head. And as my friends, as we talk about the birds, the little bird sound takes our prayer. My uncle used to love to tell me that I was like a baby bird, all mouth and full of poop. So my friends, my little bird friends.
Oh, God. Oh, we love you despite yourself. That would have been a perfect place to end, but there's someone and a set of relationships here that hasn't been explicit. And so, Charles, I want you to come up here. Come here. So I'm going to ask Charles to say a word or two, even though I didn't prepare him to do this. But, you know, I think all of you who are artists in the room who have worked with dealers or gallerists, that's the nice word they use here at the U of O, I notice. It's kind of classy. Dealer, kind of, I don't know, sounds more exciting to me. But Charles is the best. Charles is amazing. Charles is without parallel on the planet, as far as I know. And I've met a lot of gallerists around the world. And the relationship that Charles and Rick and William Jameson have is remarkable. And so I just really, I want to honor Charles and his relationship with Rick, because I know that a lot of what happens happens through Charles and Rebecca and Wilder and all of the other folks at Froelich Gallery and the work that Charles has done to bring forward William Jameson's legacy too. So you are free to say what you want, Charles.
How much time do I have? I am not prepared.
I know.
And, well, I could talk about all the times I've gotten Rick lost in other cities and he's just wanting to throttle me, you know. Or I call Seiichi and Naoki from a train station in Tokyo, and I have no idea where I am, and Rick is, of course, again, ready to throttle me. But we oh, yeah, you don't remember that. it's been fascinating to, you know, you send your message as a gallerist, you send the message out to the world for all the artists that we love and care for and are passionate about. And we want everyone to get attention. And we want everyone, Rebecca Wilder and I, we work with artists that we know deserve time and consideration and a place in history, and are they're potent and they're genuine and they're following their own personal motivations. And day in and day out, you know, we think, oh, who's gonna call today and who's gonna come in today? And you know, there are always the surprises, but every day we can say, well, there's gonna be a phone call, an email, a delivery, and someone walking in the door asking about Rick. And it's from another country or it's from just down the street. And what a joy. Rick, the genuine, you're without fear when you go into the material that you work with. I remember Lillian having a fit, and you mentioned it the other day about the clay work. Maybe not a fit, but Lillian was like, oh, you're showing Rick's clay work, huh? She's like, how long has he been doing this? And I was like, a weekend at Frank Boyden's studio.
You're being a bird.
She was... She looked at me like, I think you've lost your mind. This man needs to do a little more practice in the studio. I didn't mean it that way, but okay, maybe I did. Well, this is a dream come true for Rebecca Wilder and I. As you walk through the show upstairs, I think it's evident. I think the passion that we feel and the conviction that Rick deserves global recognition, it's present here. And the University of Oregon, Danielle, Jill, Larry, outstanding work. It has been a true joy and thrill because they've just put every ounce of integrity, and no resource was too much. They just kept going after it. And it's a real pleasure working with you guys, and inspiration. And so thank you to the University of Oregon and the Jordan Schnitzer Museum of Art. And I don't know, I think over lunch I'll be able to... you've probably seen the roasts that, is it Comedy Central does? I'm just dying to, like, if I could channel Martha Stewart's roast of Justin Bieber a little bit, Rick. But I'm a gallerist, and I will keep it classy.
Okay, well, I would just like to close by saying thank you to all of you and for sharing your stories, and to all of you in the audience. And again, I echo Charles' thanks to the University of Oregon staff and Danielle for the work that you and Jill have done, and Larry, all that you've done here. And Danielle, I want to say to you that this is going to shape your career, this experience. And so... you're one lucky young curator.
Thank you all so much. I think we'll save the questions we have on cards for if you can join us at 2. Larry and Rick and I will speak in this space, and then depending on how we all feel, if there's time, maybe we can go up in the galleries after that talk, if Rick feels up to it too. But we're planning to have our conversation happen here with this same setup. So Larry and I will tell our stories then, and look forward to hoping to see many of you back at that time. Thank you so much.